afternoon. Today is Monday, October 12th. It is 1 o'clock, and we are going to begin the regular trustee meeting, and we'll start with a pledge of allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have an agenda before us for today's meeting. Are there any additions or modifications we need to make to the agenda?
As a board, I have two, actually, for add one executive session per our Ohio Revised Code, Section 121.22G1, consider the discipline of a public employee for the investigation of charges or complaints against a public employee, and 121.22G1 to consider the compensation of a public employee.
Any other changes or additions?
And board, our attorney will be arriving and I would recommend the items.
Okay.
Do you want that?
We'll insert that when the attorney arrives.
So those were the two? Yeah.
I do. That's my meeting.
Move to approve the agenda as amended for October 12th, 2015.
Second. Ms. Garage?
Yes.
Mr. Paxton?
Yes.
Mr. Kratz?
Yes.
Approve payroll, excuse me, in the amount of $257,391.66.
Now, we'll second it, but I have my question. This is for those, whatever has been paid, worked for up to this point. And I have questions about prior votes. And I'm not sure if I should vote yes or no. So I think I'm going to pass when the vote comes up.
I'll ask quick questions on legal real quick. So if for some reason we do not approve the payroll today, what's the ramifications?
Can't pay them.
I understand that.
And then there's...
But we have a legal obligation to pay our expenses.
You do understand the law, yes.
Okay.
Mr. Paxton?
Yes.
Ms. Graff?
Because I believe our employees should be paid, even though I question possibly how the payments came about, I will vote yes on this.
Mr. Kratz?
No.
It's the bill, it's in the amount of $232,421.07.
Second.
Mr. Paxton?
Yes.
Ms. Graff?
Yes.
Mr. Kratz?
Yes.
Move to approve the regular meeting minutes of September 14th, 2015.
Second.
Ms. Graff?
Yes.
Mr. Paxton?
Yes.
Mr. Kratz?
Yes.
Approve the special meeting minutes of September 22nd.
Second.
Mr. Paxton?
Yes.
Ms. Graff?
Yes.
Mr. Kratz?
Yes.
Vote to approve the regular meeting minutes of September 28th, 2014.
Second.
Ms. Graff?
Yes.
Mr. Paxton?
Yes.
Mr. Kratz?
Yes. This time we open up the podium to any citizens desiring to speak. Seeing none, we'll move on. We have no old business, no new business. Move on to the administrator and the City of Beavercreek Equipment Agreement.
Thank you, board. On page 3 of your agenda packet is an agreement for use of township equipment. This is an agreement that we've had in the past with the City of Beavercreek. The City of Beavercreek, City Manager, and the Public Works Director and I have had discussions about renewing this agreement. The board chose not to renew it in the end of 2012 due to the annexation case that was pending. We talked about this agreement, and both sides think, including the road superintendent, that this, having this agreement in place would be beneficial for both communities. We've used this agreement twice that we know of. One was the dry Ike event where we had the hurricane come through and a lot of debris was taken down. City Blaze, we did use it on a snow, but I think we haven't used it on a snow event. But the idea is to use it not only for a snow, heavy snow event, but it also allows it for another circumstance like a natural disaster where we can assist it. One thing I'll point out that was different from the last agreement is Section 3, the duration of the agreement. This mirrors the previous agreements that we just passed this year with other shared service agreements that we've had with the city. And instead of doing an annual renewal of this, you have the out clause that's in Section 3. The only other amendment the township will have to provide is an updated Exhibit A on a yearly basis.
That's the salaries?
Yeah, that would be the salaries and the overtime and the equipment rates.
I have one question just on equipment rates. Did we calculate anything in there as far as depreciation?
The equipment rates are based on the FEMA rates, so that is all booked to the FEMA rates. The city manager has already signed this agreement, just to look forward.
I think it's a good idea to do.
The equipment that would be sent to the township to have our operators on our people on it.
Under whose supervision?
It would still be under the township supervision.
So we send a supervisor and an operator, or we send only an operator?
Well, it could be one of our foremen and an operator.
So we're recouping both costs?
Yeah, and I believe last time it was all of us were over there helping the city, so it was the road superintendent all the way down to our employees.
The windstorm, did we ever get reimbursed from?
Yes, we did.
Yeah,
and some of these events that, that, for example, other points, some of these may be reimbursable if there's a county declaration or a state declaration disaster area. So if we had a blizzard, and the governor says Green County's a disaster area because of the snow, we may be able to recoup some of these costs as well. So the city might have to pay us. They'll probably pay us and get reimbursed for it.
Make a motion to approve the agreement for the use of township equipment and authorize the township administrator to sign up for the agreement.
Second.
Mr. Paxton?
Yes.
Ms. Brown?
Yes.
Mr. Kreutz?
Yes.
Thank you, Board. Next item on the agenda starts on page 7. There's a recommendation on the fee structure that was discussed two meetings ago with the Green County Regional Planning. Green County Regional Coordinating Commission. On page 8, you'll see the breakdown of the dues, what we currently pay, and what the proposed dues are in 2016. Also provided the agreement where it shows, and it's not redlined, but there is strikeouts where the new language would be placed in the resolution and bylaws. There's also a resolution. Real consideration. On page 33.
The regional planning does all our subdivisions, review, plat reviews. I think have assisted with our land use plan in the past. I think that's is a reasonable dues for the services that we receive.
Just to point out, we have looked at comparables in the past and potentially joint shared services with other communities. And when we looked at it in the past, even with the fee increase as proposed in bylaws in front of you today, it is still a cost savings to the township instead of outsourcing it to another either community or a third party, private sector third party.
Yeah, that's a couple questions for you. You've made the comment in the past that the cost-benefit analysis, there's far more benefit, there's a significant benefit we receive from the cost we pay. If regional planning did not exist, what would we do differently?
First thing that comes to mind is that I would have to hire, I would have to retain an engineer to review plans submitted to us for approval for all subdivisions. That review cost is potentially significant. That's probably the biggest additional cost, and that alone I think would exceed what the proposed new fees would be for regional planning. So with regional planning, approval of subdivisions is an umbrella that includes review by the county engineer, sanitary engineering, soil and water, and others as needed, parks and trails. All of those folks are included in that review process, and they all make comments and participate in the deliberations that lead to final approval of construction drawings.
But
so I would have to coordinate that myself and hire appropriate expertise as I saw that it was needed. And
Do you know, or maybe Mr. Paxson knows between the two of you, what the answer would be, what percentage of their funding is based on member dues? Is it 10% or 90% of their funding?
As a percentage, I'm not sure. I know that the bulk of their funding continues to come from the county, even in this proposed revision. And I believe that percentage breaks down to about 85% from the county and 15% from member dues.
That's what I
saw. But please don't quote me on that.
I didn't know if there was other sources of funding other than these dues.
No. Okay. Well, they've also raised applicant fees as well. So fees for the use of their services by developers and contractors have also gone up. And both pieces combined are likely in the next year to finally get them some of the clerical help that they need. They're a professional staff of two. And in addition to everything that's been mentioned, they're also charged with long-range planning, address assignment, which is a bigger task than you might assume. And a couple of other things that escape me at the moment. They're available to me at the drop of a hat. I dropped in on them this morning when I announced, and I was able to spend half an hour with the staff and discuss an issue.
Based on the fee schedule, there's roughly 19 participating jurisdictions, including the county. Is our fee locked in regardless of? Is there a minimum participation of the other jurisdictions?
Our fee, if this is approved, it would be locked in for the length of this agreement. There are some potential changes in membership on the positive side. I think that the city of Fairborn is seriously considering rejoining regional planning. They've sent a trustee to each of the last four or five monthly meetings. Mr. Paxson can correct me if I'm mistaken in my recollection.
Ex officio.
Right. And other ex officio memberships could increase that as well. A couple of jurisdictions have so far declined to approve these. Though the Village of Yellow Springs has said they want the same consideration as city members, despite the fact that they use a complete array of services, whereas the city members, for which we're proposing a smaller fee, have their own planning departments and have their engineers and so forth on staff. So that's an issue that has yet to be worked out with one or two of the jurisdictions. But I think in general the reaction to this has been positive among member jurisdictions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I would move to approve the resolution. There is Beavercreek Township as a member of the Regional Planning Coordinating Commission for Yellow County, and the RPCC has proposed a modification. And Articles 13.04 of the bylaws require any modification of financial provisions to be amended only have to be confirmed by the county commissioners, the majority of the jurisdictions. And I move that we approve this modification.
Second.
Ms. Carr?
Yes.
Mr. Paxson?
Yes.
Mr. Kreutz?
Yes.
Thank you.
And it will be resolved that the Free Township confirms the amendments to the RPC bylaws.
Do you have that resolution for the next
one?
Fuel policy?
The board on page 35 is a fuel operations policy. The city of Beavercreek has created a fuel operations policy. They haven't had one in the past. Our policy mirrors theirs with the exception of just adding a few things for the township that may be different from the city's policy. Brand new policy. We are going to, as you recall, the agreement started this week. We're going to phase it in, all the equipment's in, and we're going to be starting to program all the equipment. We're going to phase the road department and the sheriff's office and conduct training with them first, see how that works, and then phase in the fire department and then everybody else to do it, fueling at the municipal fuel station.
Question on that. And it's all on there in the case of the catastrophic event, we have a few surprises. Do they have backup power source in the station? Because if fuel's out and you have massive power shock, what would they do for fuel?
Yeah, they do have a backup generator to operate it. The fuel station's only been down once in the last several years. And that was more of a software computer issue where they got a direct lightning strike to the facility down there and knocked it out for 24 hours until they were able to, IT was able to come in and reboot the system and make sure it was operating. The city is looking at different options, much like the township has, in regards to changing. Right now, their policy, they will be, if the fuel station's down, they will be given vouchers to go use at different fueling stations in the private. I did talk to Mike Fenero, Public Works Director, about potentially looking at somebody jointly, at least for the township or for the city, that wouldn't include the private. That would be our first backup, but if we had something like 9/11 where everything was shut down and the fuel station wasn't working, we may have an option of potentially working with the county if there's a stop. So,
what about the schools?
Schools is another option. We've looked at schools in the past, doing some joint operations. However, they do everything by hand, so it's still handwritten.
I was concerned about in an emergency situation when that be prime backup because it's sort of central for most of us.
It could be. We'll look at exploring that. The city will This policy still, for the township, still allows for the use of the current contracts that we have in place with Speedway and now Shell. So there's an option there. And then there's also an option to make sure that the districts are still maintained. So if for whatever reason, a piece of equipment needs to get fuel, but there's nothing left in that district, this gives them the option of contacting your supervisor and then fueling at another location. Or anybody else, road department as well, if they're something totally to the south or to the north, gives them an option of still coming all the way back to the municipal maintenance facility.
Make a motion to approve the fuel operations policy.
That's just a policy.
Second.
Mr. Heisen?
Yes.
Ms. Graham?
Yes.
Mr. Kratz?
Yes.
Thank you, Board. 2 weeks ago, the Board approved move forward with the land acquisition. I do have a motion here to move forward with finalizing, and I have a purchase request as well.
Motion to approve the purchase request to Fannie Mae, property located at 28 Virginia Road, and the amount of $28,000 for the purchase of land for public purpose, and authorize the township administration to sign all closing documents on behalf of the board.
Second.
Mr. Heisen?
Yes.
Ms. Graham?
Yes.
Mr. Kratz?
Yes.
Thank you, Board. On page 41 begins the bi-weekly sheriff's office report. We have to answer any questions or press any questions on to the sheriff.
Any questions?
That was the one detail seemed to be working.
If you've been in the area, there's been a lot of extra patrols down there. Just the other day, there was probably 4 or 5 sheriffs and cruisers that were visible.
Good.
Thank you, Board. On page 48 begins the finance department's bi-weekly report.
Finance director's not here today.
And he's off today.
Questions?
I guess I'm okay, but it's not here, so I'll wait for the next meeting.
Human resources.
Thank you, Board. On page 50, it starts the bi-weekly report for the human resources. Any questions on the human resource bi-weekly report?
I have a question on the work that we're doing for senior exchange.
Mm-hmm.
If we have to use attorneys in that situation, or have the resources to use attorneys, how is that?
Not our attorneys. In fact, they have an attorney on the negotiating
team. On their team. Okay, so they're doing the attorney. So the only thing we're doing is they're going to make the resources.
That's right.
Okay, that's good.
Yep.
Any other questions for each other? Zoning.
Thank you, Board. On page 53 is the new biweekly report with some of the information that's been passed by the board. Starts on page 53. This is version 1. Version 2 should be out next biweekly report, which will include all the PUDs and subdivisions that we have in the township. That's kind of been a lot longer project than we anticipated because there are a lot of subdivisions and PUDs. So the zoning department, they're going through all their records, including going to the White Barn and picking up old records to find how many lots were approved and so on. So this is version 1, and the next version will have the percentage. It'll have the approved homes, how many homes are in the development, and the percentage left on availability.
Thanks, Ed.
Good
work. This is interesting. Thank you. Thanks for looking.
appreciate the technical assistance from the administration.
The nice part is once you've got the model filled, now you can maintain it, but the hard part of the paint stuff is getting the model filled. Does this include, I saw, commercial structures, additions, and accessory structures, but does this include the revenue from Valley Springs Farm?
No, it does not, actually.
Okay, I didn't think it could.
No, this is only...
So even though it...
Well, it includes the fee that they paid with their initial check, but not... The reimbursement, not the reimbursement for our legal expenses.
Okay.
So that would...
This would be the net revenue then, is what you're essentially saying.
Right.
So, okay. So any pass-throughs would have been, just that.
Right.
Because I was expecting the number to spike to 2014 with all of that activity.
Well, do recall that the new fees only went into effect on June 1st.
No, I'm sorry. I'm talking about due to the Valley Springs project specifically.
Oh, okay.
Expected that number to come
out. Oh, I see.
But
no,
essentially, you're counting it as a reimbursement.
Those are just net numbers from last year.
The one thing we're working on for 2016, so 2016 will have essentially a full year of the new zoning fees. We'll be able to add another and automatically calculate year to date on revenue based on. So if you take single family dwellings at $350, we'll be able to help you with that. So there'll be a little modification in 16 on it. The difficulty was going back and going half the year would be for the first quarter with the zoning fees and then the rest of the year with the new zoning fees. So there'll be a little modification to that.
Any other questions on zoning? IT?
I do not have an IT bi-weekly report. Mr. Terry is in the mountains of California.
Any issues in your world or assignments? Road department.
Thank you, Board. The first
item. A four-letter word.
Yes. First item on the agenda starts on page 55. It's that time of year. They are saying this week we may have our first frost, so snow's right around the corner. So first item on the agenda is the purchase and sale.
This is to fill the bin.
Correct.
I make a motion to approve purchase request 00357 to Compass Minerals of America, the 500 tons of road salt that won't be used. In the amount of $34,000 and to authorize the township administrator to sign for the board.
Ms. Brown?
Yes.
Mr. Paxton?
Yes.
Mr. Friends?
Yes.
And I think we would like to keep the plows clean the whole winter so that they just stay in pristine condition and can go on and drink.
Thank you, Board. Next item is the biweekly report. Page 56, any questions?
I just have one question there on reviewing the driveway permits. And in your reviewing the permits, I guess maybe like it's not the same work that had the condition of the permit. Are you looking at the same permit in a different way?
Actually,
we're not duplicating the work. It's not a duplication of the work.
No.
Just to point out on the statistics, if you look at a new single family dwelling and then you look at the very next line of the driveway permits on the zoning report, there is a difference. And the difference is whether or not it's a township road or not. It's a county road, then they have to do the permit process.
Yeah, basically what we do is go through and make sure that where the driveway is located is within Green County standards. And on top of that, when they pour the driveway, we actually physically go out before they pour into the inspection. So
So it's not redundant, it's built on.
It's built on. And actually, up until 2 years ago, fiscal office, either my office, actually issued the permits, and then we moved them over to make it a one-stop shop.
Any other questions for Mr. Parks while he's?
Do you have any information as to removing the log jams and taking care of our little problem along Beavercreek Road, the river side? Have you seen the level of the water drop significantly?
Yeah, well, we redid the outlet structure. We actually watched, you can actually see the bottom of the culvert now. And then as we went down the LMI property, depending on where we removed the jam, you would see anywhere from 6 to 8 inches of drop, almost down to a foot, because the one at the far end was having a lot of that.
We have not had any significant events, rain events since then. So
no, we have not.
So far, we think it's going to work well.
That is our hope.
And if you look at the front section there, you can, it used to hold essentially a large amount of water. And now the water is actually flowing. There's two, we believe, two springs along Factory Road. And so what you see now is just the spring water actually flowing into the tile, which is, we've never done before. One other thing I'd like to point out is that the Township Road Department did participate in the tri-a-truck with the city of Beaver Creek at their maintenance facilities. So it's a good turnout down there. A lot of people are trying out the truck.
It's a fun event, it really is. And it's nice to see our people participating along with everyone else and people going from city maintenance facility to the fire department to see the fire trucks and vice versa. There's a lot of interaction and camaraderie. I think it's an excellent shared event.
Yes, and it's nice that the city invites us to be a part of that event as well.
Question for on Bexley Hills, when you were pushing the, I guess call phase three, I guess, of Bexley Hills through
Major B.
Well, we went through regional planning where we ran into the issue on the emergency access, the being blocked either by an eave or by a fence. It appears there, and it's in your notes too, that they're clearing for the next phase there along Shepherd. Was that issue resolved on
not,
the emergency access?
Not yet. Actually, we had a meeting this morning, Ed, myself, and Randy.
Was the house there or not there?
Maybe it's there. And there is a fence in that emergency access. Our comments were due back to regional planning on this last review, and all three of us are in agreement that a part of the access road in 3B does meet our specifications, but they have to prove that in, it's kind of weird how they numbered it, it's River West, it's Scarborough section or phase two, which is that original section of Bexley Hills. They have to prove that that access is still there, which they have to resolve the issues of the fence, the tree, and is the base still there underneath, before we'll get finished any kind of approval.
From a clarification standpoint, though, a landowner can put a fence across one of these access points.
I believe
we have
they
the right,
can.
We have the right to mow it down essentially to gain access, and it's not our obligation to put it back. If it's built in, it's no different than building something or planting something in the right of way, whether it's a utility or fire access.
However, in this case, the original agreement with the developer called for the access easement to remain clear of obstruction. That was an agreement signed by the developer. So I really don't know what that means. I mean, Ohio Revised Code, as it applies to zoning, would say that I had to issue that fence permit anyhow, even though I knew it to encroach into the easement because it's his property, with the proviso that it can come out at his expense. in this case, one of the problems there is, well, there are two main problems. There are also trees planted, one of which is at least a 4-inch diameter tree now. And the fence was set in concrete. So while our fire trucks could barrel through there if they needed to, while they have the legal right to do so, A, they do damage to our equipment, and B, it's questionable that they could because the actual physical roadbed has been removed in the construction of the homes, and we believe that it's the developer's responsibility to put that roadbed back. If he, it, as long as he chooses that this is the route of his emergency access, he has other options, but he's chosen this one. As long as he does so, he has to prove that it's a usable emergency access.
If we determine at some point in the future that we've either issued a permit for a fence that goes across one of these easements,
right.
Is it our standard practice to go back and send them a notification that there's a correction?
We have met with the homeowner.
Okay. I've met with the homeowner who put the fence up. He's considering his...
Same with the landscaping. You know,
right,
would come
exactly.
Out and stake the tree down.
Exactly.
They just got the
so the answer out. Is it's
still
it's
in
not,
process.
It's not resolved, but
no.
Until you're working through it.
Yeah, we're working through it. I actually think I am going to guess at the regional planning level, at some point it's going to become a
hot button issue,
and a go ask an attorney on what that record plan says. I would like to mention one thing I forgot to put in my biweekly report. Is we were fortunate enough to get part of the Cargill Morton Salt settlement. If you didn't see the letter in your thing, we were fortunate enough to get $3,640. So that's more than we had before.
And that goes back to the same fund that we would have spent the time buying.
Yeah.
$34,000 just.
Well, it's considered new money.
Yeah, considering the money.
It wouldn't be a reduction. It would be considering the money into that fund.
Into that fund.
Yes.
Thank you. Something about a log jams on the Kugler wetlands property.
Yes.
You know, another beaver decided to build another dam there.
We're not sure if it's a beaver or a family of beavers.
Okay.
I know last week it was a constant battle. So Friday, when we got another trapper in, we would set some more traps because we would tear it out, and they would come back in and build three overnight. We tear it out the next morning, and they come back in and build two or three more.
And each time they build them, they cut down more trees is what they're doing.
They're cutting down trees, or back where this is, you can't physically get it all out because it's so wet. So we're stacking it along the shore, kind of out of the way.
And then we're using.
I think some of them they're reusing, but some of it is new. So they're industrious little guys. Let me
just
help you there.
And they're very close to trade line is that one. The New Germany trade line and that's why
that little
concerned
bridge
about the bridge the
yeah, that little bridge.
Yeah.
Before we took the dam out, it was right at the bottom of the steel. Once we took the first one out, it dropped about a foot and a half. And brought some of the water over in the wetlands and drained part of that property out by New Jersey trade line and so forth.
Any questions or comments? Going to fire.
Thank you, Board. On page 57 begins the first item is a purchase request related to the EMS panel. Starting on page 57 is the answers to questions in regards to the purchase. We also have the two bags that we're going to be replacing here today. And I tried to lift up the blue one. That one's pretty heavy.
Yes. So the as you read in the 13 points here, we're looking to replace two bags. The first bag is what we refer to as our first in bag. It's designed to provide everything necessary for providing patient care for the first, essentially, 5 minutes of patient contact.
The second bag, in this case, the orange bag, is the critical care bag, and that is for dealing with patients who have generally critical injuries, hence the name critical care. So it's used a lot on both crashes, that sort of thing, and cardiac arrests and those types of events. The bags themselves are kind of a evolutionary product, so over the years they've changed forms a number of times. We are looking right now, since we're in the process of evaluating the entire system, of reconfiguring the bags, which will redistribute the weight a little bit. It will lighten the blue bag, the first in bag, which is basically used on every patient contact. Probably drop the weights by about 5 to 10 pounds. It's probably in the 35 pound range right now. And it will transfer some of the weight to the critical care bag, which is used a little bit less frequently. In addition to redistributing the equipment, so all the same types of equipment will still be carried between the two, just in a slightly different configuration. The bags themselves will have a slightly different layout to make it easier to access the equipment, and the materials themselves are going to be more infectious resistant, including resistant to bed bugs, which is our new nemesis, the BMS. So, it's part of a 2015 budgeted line item. It was actually budgeted in 2014, but the study was not done to determine what the new solution should be. So it is a carryover from last year, and the crews have, like I said, worked through evaluating everything, what they want to do, what they're trying to accomplish. They've evaluated a number of bags themselves, and this is a recommendation. I can very well dump all the contents out if you'd like to see them. Speaking of contents, I'm sorry, I should have mentioned. The price is for the bags themselves. The contents of these bags will essentially get redistributed into the new. Several of the old bags that are still serviceable will remain with us in different uses, and then the rest will be surplus out.
There's a motion on page 58.
I move to approve the purchase request 08101 to Boundtree Medical for EMS bags replacement in the amount of $4,882.87, and to authorize the township administrator to sign for the board.
Second.
Any further discussion?
Did you say that was for two bags or more,
no.
more than two bags?
It two bag uses, but it is 17 bags for the first in, and I can't remember the count on the other, so. It is more than two bags, yes.
Thank you. Ms. Graff?
Well, it's to replace all the blue bags and all the orange bags.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes.
Mr. Paxton?
Yes.
Mr. Kratz?
Yes.
Thank you, Board. Next item is on page 58. It's a purchase request. Actually, the purchase requests are all related
right.
to this. This is something that we've talked about at length for 2 years in regards to updating the community room. One of the things, this is the original carpet in here, and we're going to be taking out two of the trip hazards as well in the middle of the room. But the first purchase request is starts on page 58, number 2. And that will be for the new carpet and new bed, kitchenette and fridge out to the hallway. Some additional room. The training room will be set up, and as you can see now, so if there's training or there's community room use by someone from the outside, it will face the wall that we're currently facing with the two projectors, and then obviously the same configuration will be moved around for trustee meetings, zoning meetings, and BZA meetings.
We can get a motion and maybe some discussion.
Motion is on the first motion.
Motion to approve the following purchase request 08012, multiple services, the new carpet and kitchenette relocation in the amount of $14,441, and to authorize the township administrator to sign for the board.
Second. Discussion.
Because my question is, what's wrong with what we have?
The carpet obviously needs to be replaced. There's several tears in there. Two of the four outlets that are in do not work, and there's about to come up. so we're going to keep two and then fill in the other two.
Maybe they're not repairable, or they're, I'm just asking.
From day one, they've always held water.
Oh, it's horrible.
And we would update the carpet to...
Would you replace them, or would you eliminate them?
We're eliminating two of them, I believe.
The two that are rotten?
Yeah.
Believe it's, actually, it's two, if not three, and keeping this one back here, because this one back here is still serviceable.
And that also includes moving that whole back corner?
Yes, ma'am.
Out of the room to give more room, space in this room, and to reduce the damage of the carpeting, because also the refreshments are coming out of the kitchenette, so to put those over a tile floor.
Yeah, we would prefer that eating and drinking be over a tile and not permitted in the carpeted area. The carpeted area would also be used, or be the new style of carpet that we've done in the rest of the township buildings, including some of the other fire stations. It's the square, so if there's damage to one of the squares, tiles, we can just replace the tile, and we have extras to, and we have replaced a couple tiles already with the, throughout the township.
Back there as part of the original design, and I think it's been light. Change things around a little bit. It's a bit large. Some people have a lot of time putting the roof on there.
Can we seal those on? I mean, is there any electrical wiring running to them now, or has that been muted?
No, it has been disconnected at the box. And basically what would happen here is they would ground them in, and they would just become part of the floor.
And hopefully you can keep the water out.
Do we have any carpet that we can match those with? Two that we need?
Not as much knowledge. Not at this time.
Can you put a flat cover plate on? Just like on a wall socket, just want to taper down and
we haven't investigated that.
Probably have some fabricator. If you couldn't find anything.
As long as they'll be part of the floor and not being used, they can fill them in. So there's no need. What are we filling them in with?
Mr. Parks is referring to grounding them in. I'm assuming that's...
Yes.
That's what the suggestion. Then the carpet goes right over the floor. Whatever.
Well, if we're not concerned about the appearance, we could just get some samples of patching things.
Yeah, you could also just put a piece of ceramic tile over. If you're going to grout it in, put a one square of tile over. These three motions that we're tying together, correct?
They're separate in regards. They're related to the upgrades in the room, but they're separated out by the projects within the room.
Okay, so the first one is purely the remodeling.
Yeah, the first motion that's on the table is for the new carpet and kitchenette relocation.
Do you need any of the cabinets there at all?
No.
No, if we do the project as designed, they would all come out of here.
And are we at a max capacity ever in this room?
Well, we can probably fit more in here legally than would comfortably fit, if that answers the question. So moving the cabinets isn't really a matter of occupancy.
Right.
The more a matter of functionality, distraction for where people have to go to get the refreshments and things like that. So they're absolutely, it's not mission critical sort of change, it is much more functional type of change.
Sure. Ms. Brock?
Yes.
Mr. Paxton? Mr. Krebs?
No. We have two more motions.
I would leave if we didn't do the first one, then there's no point in doing the rest either.
Actually, I would appreciate consideration of the next two.
Okay, that's what I understood. So walk us through, I'm sorry, one more time, but we'll have to do it in 3 hours. I apologize.
Yeah, that's right. Next motion is on page 60. This would be to replace the tables and chairs. Some of the chairs are starting to become in bad condition. Some of them are broken and those have been removed. So starting on, you can see pictures in the back of the report given by the fire chief on the tables and chairs. The tables will be a little more functional in regards to either on calisters, easier to move them around, and functionality, as well as the chairs.
But we're replacing the chairs and tables we have with the new chairs and tables.
That's right.
And walk us through any there.
Again, the chairs themselves, we'll be replacing the slide style chairs. The chairs that are coasters, so they'd be easier to move. They nest in a different way, so instead of stacking and having to stack them, move the stack around, then unstack, they nest together so they can be moved. So as the room gets configured between the public side uses versus the board and other commission uses, which happens on a fairly regular basis now, it'll speed up and ease the crew's ability to transition. Same thing with the tables. Instead of having the flip-down fold tables, they're a fold-on casters type table, and again, will just allow the moving around and reconfiguration of the room to be much easier. This is still a very, very heavily used space between all of the official functions, all the fire department functions, and the public functions. It gets reconfigured almost on a daily basis, so what we're looking to do is make it easier for the folks who have to do that, which are usually the crews, but oftentimes the people who come and use this space as well to do that. So as the board, you guys have the unique opportunity to come in and find a room set up for you. Most other folks have to come in and make this space usable for themselves. So it's the ability to ease that process is the need for the additional chairs and tables.
At least in other office environments I've been in, wouldn't the casters deteriorate the carbon caster here?
That I don't know.
Okay. Without it. I mean, normally, if you're going to put casters on carbon, you put a hard plastic chair protector over.
Yeah, and I'm not sure between sliding these slides and the other
tile. To me, it almost be better.
And that's probably not a bad
from
idea.
A sound standpoint, the carbon's probably better.
I could bring you back a purchase request for some tile. I don't know how that would fare.
That would be my concern on casters. So I don't disagree. It's easier to roll than it is to pick up or slide. If you slide, you can carbon either way. So, again, that sounds like a need. It's not like a desire, not a need.
It is.
Okay.
Actually, these chairs have like runners, which I think is help extend the longevity of the car. Because it's sliding. So, are we looking at having these chairs evaluated or repaired?
Evaluated keeping
these spaces really.
Well, the ones that have been broken. Yeah, the ones that have been broken have failed, at least the ones I pulled out at the weld. So at the weld point, so usually where an individual would sit is the back sections have failed. So they sit in it and then it drops. So the welds on some of them are pretty bad. And the ones that haven't been thrown out because of that.
This style of chair, I believe you can. I can say I'm 100% positive, but I'm at least 98% positive you can still get those at Lyric's used or lightly used if you ever need to replace them. So my preference is to spend a those kind of things in medics versus replacing functional chairs that they can. That's my preference. So if we're going to spend money, I'd spend twice as much on those as we could be in half of the.
And the crews will appreciate that.
We have a motion, or we don't have a motion?
There's currently no motion on that.
Want to make a motion?
If we don't, we're not remodeling in that remodel. How many chairs do we have that are functional? Right now, there are 30 in here, 35 or 40. Do we have any more in the room?
There's a staff back there as well. What's the max capacity we normally would have?
40 to 50, 154?
Well, that needs to be updated since we moved this in. So that's probably the old occupancy.
That is.
Yeah. So that needs to be recalculated.
So again, the occupancy versus what's comfortably fitted here, probably two different things.
Okay. The third item?
Third item is to update the whiteboards and add document hangers. The one that's behind the screen over there is magnetic. The other two are not, which is requiring us to use tape. There'll be a strip, I believe, above the whiteboard that will allow documents to hang, much like we've done in my office and the zoning office, to hang maps and different things instead of using tape or magnets on the whiteboard.
Are they no longer cleanable?
I think this one has been written on with something that was not cleanable. So if I remember correctly, that's the one, and it's underneath the taped maps right now, which I think is how the maps got taped there.
I was going to ask, when were those maps that got up there?
Yeah, there's a permanent marker, I believe, under the zoning map that we brought over.
And so you're replacing those three boards?
I thought it was just this one board and then the document hangers. I don't believe the other two. Do you have a counting map?
It would be like those in classrooms, just a strip, and then you put pins into the strip.
Either that, or I think it's the cam type where you just slide it up and then you can pop it.
If you replace that board, where do you put the maps?
There would be in the document hanger above it.
If you replace the board and hang the maps back.
Yeah, so the maps would still be there, but you can take the maps down when you're working on the board and replace them.
Okay.
Or we could take the maps down altogether. I think they're more for board use than they are for others.
The maps are valuable.
The purchase request, if there's a motion, is for one whiteboard and then.
So 4x8 magnetic, I believe, which is why it's expensive.
And then the hang tight, which according to this is 8, so I'm going to send them over each one. So it's 6 foot, I'm sorry. 6 foot, 188.
Assuming that you're predicated on the fact that you're asking for this because you need this third board, I would support it up to that amount, but I would ask, I was just at Mendelssohn's. I would ask that you at least check Mendelssohn's and Larynx or something like that and see if they have a used one. Because in many cases, they're still very useful. It just was a company that went out of business, so they picked it up for pennies on the dollar.
Okay.
So that'd be my only request.
I don't know if you could actually buy the hanger itself and fasten it to the board that's there.
The hangers will be a strip.
It's a separate item.
It's a separate item, and it's designed. Use a lot when we're meeting with developers in Ed's office. It's designed where you can just snap it in and then to take it down and put another map in, you just kind of pull it towards you and it automatically drops. Keeps it from tearing. So I know in Ed's office we use the zoning and then some of the other maps that he has on a frequent basis.
But when we would have zoning hearings in here, is when you would be using them rather than those tripods that would replace the.
Yeah, and most of the, if we're having BZA or zoning commission, they'll be used in here to hang maps for fire department trainings and for anything else that for the community rooms, whether it's Kohl's or some of the other investment groups that meet in here on a regular basis.
Motion.
Second.
on page 16, last one.
Move to approve purchase request 08103 to Whiteboard A to Z for whiteboard and document hangers in the amount of $1,469, but not to raise that. Mr. Kress suggested that at least for the board, you go out to look. This is the purchase request with specific.
And actually,
I think that has to be, that motion needs to be reconfigured.
If the amount. The board's direction is sufficient, the amount is less than what is required in and of itself for board approval. We could go out, check, do our due diligence, and make sure there is not a cheaper option. And then if it's
so
not,
I want to
we
know
can
how.
Pursue this.
Okay.
And then we can report back.
I make a motion to approve the purchase of a whiteboard and document hangers, not to exceed $1,500.
I appreciate that. We can make that happen. Second.
Not to exceed $1,500. Ms. Graff?
Yes.
Mr. Paxson?
Yes.
Mr. Kratz?
I'm all there as the township administrator. So. Yes.
Thank you, board. On page 61 is the fire department's biweekly report. Any questions for the chief?
I don't have one on the report, and it goes back to perhaps an earlier discussion. Received a call from a plat in the city, actually one of the villas, I think it was, and the question was, person put a planter in the emergency access. Who do they go to see that that is removed? And I suggested city zoning and planning rather than fire department. Is that accurate?
That is still a topic that has yet to be resolved. City planning and zoning, I don't know what their overall authority is. I also am not quite sure what their interest level is at this point. That's, again, part of that ongoing discussion we need to complete. If you have the information, I can forward it to our Fire Prevention Bureau, and they can definitely, they'll have the interest in getting it resolved, and they can work with the city to do so. So our Fire Prevention Bureau may be a good first stop, and then we can bring in whatever.
Is this a brand
resources.
New one? Right? Those are still in construction, as a matter of fact, the flat.
Yeah.
And so the emergency access is relatively new, and it'll be in one of the newer zoning requirements. So speak to these prevention people and give them the name of the contact.
I appreciate that. And it's one of those things where I'd like to say it would be as simple as talking to city zoning, but I don't know what priority level they would have, and I don't know what their overall outlook is on dealing with these. Our fire prevention guys can work with them, though they have ongoing relationships with city zoning, so they can make the contact over there just as easily and probably get an extra thing.
Any other questions for fire? Okay. At this point, for a motion to go.
The only thing left on the agenda is three items.
Go
relatively
policies,
missing.
I didn't
yeah.
Take any time for
that, so. It should be relatively quick.
I think we're on that.
Okay.
Legal advisor.
We have the two policies back. First of all, with the public record retention policy, you'll note on page 83 of the packet, we made the change that we discussed that the charges would be determined annually by the board and set forth in the township fee schedule. And then we added a form that actually we had gotten from another entity that is helpful in going through the process in terms of redaction. I didn't get any other questions or comments, so if there's anything else.
It looked like you made the change we talked about. The redaction section was comprehensive.
Yeah, the board, just to point out that the redaction form is fillable through PDF, so We will be able to put the line at the top, the public records request, so that we can name it. And then each, where it says number of pages and so on down, we'll be able to enter numbers or notes in there as well.
It makes it easier because technically by statute, you're supposed to indicate why things are redacted. So this makes it simpler for the individual filling the request, or it's supposed to anyway.
Okay.
I did look at it. I think your question, Mr. Kurtz, was to make sure, did you talk to Mr. Terry as far as the... Yeah, are you able to follow through with what you say you're going to be able to do?
Well, I think that's really
that the next
that's
one.
That's the next one.
Okay. Okay.
So.
And I did have more time to look at it, so thank you.
So if the board's okay with that, I just need a simple motion approving the records retention and public records policy as presented.
I so move.
Second.
I do have a question. Has our records commission met? This is the last meeting that was determined. Okay, has it met this year?
We have not. We attempted to, and I had a conflict.
I got no idea.
You have 2.5 months.
Right.
We have time. Yeah. Any other discussion?
No.
Ms. Graff?
Yeah.
Mr. Hexon?
Yes.
Mr. Kratz?
Yes. PED policy?
The PED policy, we made one change on page 95 that just indicated that, you know, nothing in this policy was intended to basically supersede or override the revised code. The revised code governs. With regard to Mr. Terry, he did have a copy of the policy. I didn't hear anything from him, but I know he's been out. And I will say that the technical portions, I think all of the technical portions of this policy were taken from the prior policy that was already in place.
I move to approve the personal electronic device policy as presented.
Any discussion?
Was this policy that the fiscal office is going to have reviewed?
That was both of us.
I did. Yeah, from what legal is telling us, that it puts the onus on the employee to provide the records.
Right. This is intended to make individuals that are...
If a request comes through, the township will request the record from the individual. The individual says there's no such record that exists, then the township will fulfill its obligation.
Right. It just, the fiscal office just simply has to ask because it's
right.
The responsibility of the individual.
And then if it's determined later that a record did exist, it's the individual's problem that stated it incorrectly or intentionally incorrectly.
Correct.
Not the township's. Yes or no? Technically, it falls back on
the township. Technically, it still falls back on the township. But the purpose then of the policy is then it would be a violation of a township policy, which the township could then take whatever action is necessary.
Yeah, but we'll have it on record. Where a request is sent out from the fiscal officer to the individuals to provide that information. If the information comes back in electronic format, there's a record of it that says, I have them. And then if it's determined later on, then yes, the township is still responsible, I think. But if we can show our due diligence as a township,
sure.
That yes, we asked for it, we got a response back, here's a copy of the response, they have none. If it is proven later, I think that's more against the individual. Yet again, I think the township is still going to be responsible for that. So,
let me ask you this. This is my concern. Before, once we start bringing state policy and interjecting that into local policy, who's going to oversee this? All right, so if somebody requests a text message from somebody. Any text and it's not there, somebody says it's not there. Then who's obligated to pursue that and make sure? At that one point in time, does the township then retain somebody and go after somebody's private device?
What we've
seen in the past to prove whether it's legitimate or not? Because I don't like that policy for elected officials because
well,
we operate off of a higher level of that anyway, it's there above us anyway, so.
Well, it's, this is saying nothing different than what the law already obligates you as an elected official to do.
Right, but does this allow, suit, let's say, laterally from, colleagues to pressure, pressure for the documents on a device to see if it's in fact not?
That would be up to the requester. What we're seeing statewide in some of the case laws, and I sat in the class that, at least on the state level, for the Attorney General's office that handles this, it is the, once the, if the elected official says, no, there's no text message, no, there's no emails, and the requester says, well, I don't believe that, then they're going to have to take it to court, and then the court is going to have what we call, in the legal world, is a forensic person to come in and look at all the emails and say, yes, this is township related, and this one's personal. So what I've said for 4 years now, please do not use personal email accounts when doing business with the township.
Well, I don't understand that. Yeah. I've had training in the office of some trouble, but what I'm saying is if I make a request and I'm not satisfied,
you have to appeal to higher authority.
Oh, okay. So I can't go to my colleague and say, and the township then spend money to go into somebody's email account or
no, it would be as if you were any other requester making a public records request.
Okay.
Yeah. So
no different thing. Yeah.
If you as the requester, as stated before, you as the requester do not believe that the request is fulfilled, then you go to a higher power, which is the court, and say, I believe that they're saying there is no email or text messages, but I believe there are. What the court will do is then probably assign somebody, a neutral party, to come in to your personal email accounts and have to do a kind of forensic scientific review of that email account and say, this is township related, this is not, or there's none. And when it goes back to the court, they will just say, if there are none, there are none. They will fulfill the obligation.
I could just see it getting awfully expensive.
It is. I will tell you, it is getting
stated. How involved this crux far, whatever it might be, and expensive.
Whether this said it applied to elected officials or not, the expense and the obligations would be no different.
And it is becoming on a state level.
The question I think Mr. Braxton is asking, or part of the question is, what authority has the ability to compel you to reveal your personal records, and that authority is the court?
Well, personally. Starts with you personally. And then second, then the courts.
Correct.
So the requester would have to come back and say, I think there is, even though it's been reported there isn't. So, okay. So really, this policy starts with you as an individual, any of us, either the employees or elected officials, and then the next would be the obligation of the requester to take it to court. Now, I will tell you, there are a lot of court cases based on this, and then there's a whole division in the state attorney general's office that's all they do. That's all they handle now is public records requests. We're getting public records requests, as reported by myself to the board, from agencies out in Florida, you know, that are asking for this information, and we have to provide it. So go back to the first policy, we now have a little more clear understanding and some paperwork to help provide that information. Because a lot of times, there aren't any records. So then we would just give them simply that form. And then this one, it starts with the individual, and then if the requester feels that they're not satisfied, then they have, under the law, they have every opportunity to go to this court and request for that. Now, who pays for the forensic investigation? That's a, that'll have to be determined.
This PED policy covers far more than it covers use of that cell phone.
Yes.
We'll call it township time, social media, there's all kinds of
stuff. Yes.
Right. This incorporates what's currently in place and adds to the policy that the board has to look at.
I have a motion. Yes.
Ms. Graff?
Yes.
Mr. Paxton?
Yes.
Mr. Kreitz?
Yes.
the amounts and rates.
To accept the amounts and rates as determined by the Green County Budget Commission, that we authorize the necessary tax levies and certify them to the Green County Auditor so we collect them. Second.
Ms. Brock?
Yes.
Mr. Paxton?
Yes.
Mr. Crouch?
Yes. And at this time,
move to go into executive session pursuant to Ohio Revise Code 121.22G1 to consider the discipline or charges of the consider the discipline of a public employee or the investigation of charges or complaints against a public employee, and to consider the compensation of a public employee.
Ms. Brock?
Yes.
Mr. Paxton?
Yes.
Mr. Crouch?
Yes.
Board will stay in Mr. Mullins and the fire chief.
Executive session at 2:51.
Second.
Yes, yes, and yes.
Yes.
And do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
At 2:52.
Yes.